Well, good morning. We continue our series on the good and beautiful God today. And a couple weeks ago, we had here at our church a screening of, it's redundant, screening of the movie Screenagers. I don't know how many, if any parents or young people that were at the Screenagers viewing a couple weeks ago, I know I was there. We had over 150 youth and adults, parents and teenagers together talking about social media, talking about screen time, whether it be video games or social media or texting or phones. And it was a documentary about just how the impact of technology is having on not only the teenagers, but also the parents. It wasn't all one-sided. You think, oh, it's all about the teenager. No, the parents are also having some screen things going on too. So it was really looking at how we're accessing technology. And one of the things that struck me as a father, as a parent of two daughters, is that they interviewed some young women and how they were interacting with social media. And one of the things that young women were doing is they were showing all the great lengths that young women were going to post an image of themselves online. And there was one young woman in particular that had a professional camera on a tripod in her room, and it was set up like a shooting studio. And she would work very hard for hours taking the right angle shot of herself, and then she would go to Photoshop, and then she would edit that image before she would post it online. And the whole point of it being is, how many likes am I going to get for that image? How many people are going to follow me? How many friends will I get? How many people will unfriend me? And so it gave me a pause as a dad. And looking at my daughters, and I always want my daughters to get their worth from the fact that they're my daughters. They're loved unconditionally, no matter what. And no matter what others say about them, I want them to know that they have worth that comes from somewhere else. And it just broke my heart that we live in a society that's all about getting that like or getting that follower. And that we're gaining our worth, we're actually assessing our worth based on that, based on what other people think about us. We live in this society of performance-based acceptance. It's not just Twitter, it's not just social media, it's not just Facebook. It's everywhere, isn't it? It's your job, at school, in the community. You know, it's all about performance, performance, performance. Is that where we get our worth? Is that where we get our love? Because today we're talking about God being love, that God is love. And so what is the way that God loves us? How do we know that God loves us? Is it because we perform a certain way? Well, that's what we're looking at, the gospel lesson this morning, right? There was a group of people who were saying, you know, we're about religious performance. And you're accepted based on your religious performance. And here Jesus is hanging out with sinners and tax collectors. Like I've said before, tax collectors were so bad, they had their own category of sin. There were sinners, and then there were tax collectors. Because the tax collectors, they were greedy. They took advantage. They were in league with the Roman government. They took advantage of the common folks and overtaxed them so they could make more money and get wealthy. And many tax collectors were wealthy by extorting money out of everybody else. So that's why they had their own category. They were not just sinners, they were really bad sinners. So here Jesus calls Matthew and says to Matthew, Matthew, follow me, you're a tax collector. So Matthew leaves his tax collecting business and he follows Jesus. He gives up his pursuit of wealth. He gives up his pursuit of greed and gaining more. And he follows Jesus. And so then he decides, I'm going to have a dinner and I'm going to invite everybody I know. And who does Matthew know? Tax collectors, sinners, other people that don't have the perfect religious performance. And he invites them to his house for dinner, and he invites Jesus. He's saying to them, this guy changed my life. My soul is better having been a follower of Jesus. I want you to know what it is to follow. I want you to know the grace and love and mercy of God in Jesus Christ. So here in the Bible gathers one of the first churches. We think Acts is about the first church, but really, if you think about it, this is the first gathering of a church. And now it's full of sinners. And I think the title, if I were to name this church, I would call it the Church of All Sinners. Actually, I think that's a great name for a church. Because, you know, and in fact, I Googled it. I said, I wonder if there's any church out there with this name. And I could not find one. I found one called Church of All Sinners and Saints, you know, had to clean it up a little bit. But really, if you think about it, every church is a church of all sinners. But we beautify our name, you know, we say Church of All Saints, Church of the Holy Anointed Ones, you know, we clean it up a little bit. We make it look more palatable, right? But Jesus, the first church Jesus went to, one of the first churches, was all sinners. And the Pharisees had a problem with that. And they were arguing because, you know, they're not living up to the religious performance. We don't like them. If they had a social Facebook account, the Pharisees would not be hitting the like button. They would not be following these people. But Jesus is, which says something about God. Now, why is he gathering with this church of all sinners? Well, he says, you know, they're sick. He's not condoning their sin. He's not saying it's a good thing to be a tax collector, but he's saying they're sick. They need help. They need healing. They need mercy, right? Because they, like all of us, have what we just sang about, a sin-sick soul. I want you to think about Matthew's soul as a tax collector. What was it all about for him? What was that pursuit of wealth and greed doing to his soul? Jesus said, what does it profit a person if they gain the whole world and yet forfeit their soul? So he's pursuing wealth and greed and more, and it's not really filling his soul. It's not really creating a healthy soul. And how is he treating other people as a result of that soul? He's taking advantage, abusing, not loving other people because his soul is sin sick. So, but when he finds Jesus, when he gets introduced to Jesus, Jesus starts to show him and reveal to him that his worth comes not from his wealth, but from God's love for him. Wow. And that's what heals our soul. That's what heals our sin sickness, is knowing that God loves us, that knowing God values us, that knowing that God wants to be with us. So there's this church of all sinners with sin-sick souls. Jesus has come to heal us. That's God's love at work. And so this is the other thing I love about Jesus in this passage, is that Jesus, the great physician, makes house calls. I don't know any doctors who make house calls anymore. No offense to the doctors in the house. But Jesus shows up in Matthew's house, shows up where Matthew lives, which is just the way God's love works, right? God shows up where we are. God shows up in our lives because God loves us. I want you to think about how far would you be willing to go for someone you loved? How far would you be willing to travel for someone you love? Gentlemen, remember when you were in love? You're still in love, sorry. I just set you up. Mess that up, yep. Woo. Let me rewind that. Rewind the tape. Glad my wife comes to 11 o'clock. All right. So you remember romance. Let's go to romance, right? So you remember how far you were willing to go to be with that person you were falling in love with? You would travel across the country, travel great distances. Or parents, have you ever gone away far away from your kids and traveled far away from your kids? I know my wife and I, we went to Korea for 10 days. And it was like, it's like over 24 hours to get back from Korea back to the U.S. And I remember that was the longest flight in human history to me, because I couldn't wait to get back to my kids because I love them. Why? I was willing to travel great lengths to be with them. How far were you on? I'm going to put you guys on the spot. How far have you traveled to be with someone you loved? Anybody? Korea? Asia? Where? England? England. And you couldn't just wait to get back to that person that you love, right? Where else? Hawaii? That doesn't count. Sorry, Hawaii, if you're in Hawaii. It doesn't count. No, I'm kidding. But it's a long way. Australia, you know, all the way around the world, right? And you just couldn't wait to get back, right? Where? Vermont, yeah. Traveling back and forth to Vermont. Some trips are not as far away, but just as hard to do, right? So they're still, it's hard sometimes to be away or to be away from family. So I want you to think about this. How far did Jesus travel to be with us? If God exists outside time and space, outside the known universe, which is 46 billion light years across, how far was God willing to go to be with us? How far was God willing to go to come be with us, to show up in our lives, to come and be with us? And notice that Jesus, the Son of God, doesn't just enter across the known universe, but Jesus not only shows up on our planet, but notice where Jesus shows up, not in church, but in a house full of tax collectors and sinners. Why? Because God's love. Not based on performance and acceptance, but based on the fact that they are created by the God of the universe. Do you know that God loves you, the God of the universe loves you with an unconditional love, an unfailing love, that you were worth showing up for? You were worth traveling across the 46 billion light year universe to be in your life? That's the God of love that we're talking about. That's the God that Jesus is trying to reveal, not only to the sinners and tax collectors, but also to the Pharisees. Now, I'm going to give you my translation of the Greek this morning. You see, the same word in the Greek text that Jesus uses for Matthew, when he comes to Matthew, he uses the same Greek word with Matthew to call Matthew to follow. He uses the same word when he addresses the Pharisees, but he uses it slightly different context in a different way. And if I were to translate it, what he says to the Pharisees, he says this: go disciple yourself. Go do it yourself. If you're not going to follow me, if you're not going to listen to me, then go disciple yourself. Go figure it out yourself. And he says what they need to learn. He says what they need to do. How many of us have been trying to disciple ourselves? Right? We've been trying to do it on our own. We've been trying to do it without God's love. We've been trying to do it without God's mercy. We've been trying to do it without following Jesus. We disciple ourselves. We try and do it ourselves because we tend to think, well, I'm not really that bad. I'm not in the tax collector category. We kind of line ourselves up somewhere in some other category of sin. And we go, well, I'm not that bad, so I'm okay. I don't really need all that love and mercy and forgiveness stuff. You know it's possible to have cancer and not know it? Do you know it's possible to walk around with heart disease and not know it? It is possible to have a sin-sick soul and not know it. And so we can keep trying to disciple ourselves, or we can let Jesus disciple us. We can let the God of love, the God of grace, the God of mercy to disciple us. But the Pharisees aren't willing to do that. So he says, go learn this. Go disciple yourself. And then he quotes from the prophet Hosea. Now, these Pharisees would have known exactly the book he was quoting from. I think it's interesting that Jesus pulls a verse from the prophet Hosea. Because if you want to know a little bit more about Hosea, Hosea was the prophet who married a woman of the night. He married someone who was unfaithful. He married someone who was a really big sinner. Because he was saying to the people of Israel, you have been unfaithful to God. And the whole message of Hosea is, God is faithful and loving towards you even when you're not faithful to God. What is Jesus doing by eating with sinners and tax collectors? He's saying, God loves you even though you have not been in love with God. Even though you have not been faithful to God, God is still faithful to you. So he's quoting from Hosea, the prophet who married the woman of the night. I'm cleaning it up for you, folks. So this woman of the night he's married to, he's saying that. And in that context of Israel's unfaithfulness, because they had turned to other gods, they were going and doing other things and worshiping Baal and all these things I won't go into. So he says to them this. He says, I desire mercy mercy, not sacrifice. What he's saying is this word here in Hebrew in Hosea is this word from Hebrew called hesed. Now, we know if you've been here before, hesed means the unfailing love of God, the steadfast love of God, this love from God that doesn't give up on us, even when we give up on God. So that's what this is saying. He's saying to the Pharisees, I want you to go learn what it means to love people no matter what. I want you to go learn what it means to have an unfailing love, because I'm not so concerned about religious performance as I'm concerned with us doing God's will of showing mercy instead of sacrifice. Now, their religious performance was about sacrifice. They went to the temple, they would sacrifice to make themselves look get better. So they thought healing for their soul came with offering sacrifices at the temple. They also thought that physical healing for people who were ill was done at the temple as well. So if somebody were sick or ill, they would offer a sacrifice for them at the temple, and they would offer that sacrifice in hopes that God would heal them. And so this was the system that Jesus was speaking into. So when he says, I desire mercy, not sacrifice, he's saying, I would rather you love people than just keep going to the temple. I'd rather you go love people with this unconditional, unfailing love rather than just going to this sacrificial system over and over again. But before we get too hard on the Pharisees, let me ask a question. How concerned are we for the souls of other people? Not just their physical health. Are we really concerned for the spiritual health of others around us? And do we want them, like Matthew, to experience the healing power of God's love and grace and mercy in their lives through Jesus Christ? Or are we just praying for their health, their physical health? How often when we gather do we pray for people's physical health? Most of the time. Now, it doesn't mean that we're not praying for people's spiritual health. But I want to shift us a little bit and say it's not just about caring for people's physical health. Our bodies are going to one day disappear. Our souls are eternal. So are we praying for God's love and healing for the soul of our friends, of our family, of our neighbors, of our community, of the people around us? Do we love them enough to pray for that healing of the soul? Because that's what Jesus calls us to do as followers. And I'm not saying let's go out there and share our faith to make our church bigger or to fix people. You know, sometimes we're like the Pharisees. We say, yeah, they need Jesus. Let's go fix them. Let's sick Jesus on them, you know. We're not talking about that. We're talking about a quote I shared with you earlier this year that says that we believe following Jesus makes our lives better and makes for a better life. That God's love and grace and mercy in Jesus Christ makes for a better life. Why wouldn't we want that for somebody else? Why wouldn't we pray that for somebody else? Because God loves us. God loves us deeply, and we want others to experience and to know that love of God that is hesed, unfailing, unconditional. So learn mercy, not sacrifice. So to help us learn mercy and to learn unfailing love, I've got some soul training for you this morning. I'm not going to dance this week. I did it last time. So I want you to do this. This is a soul practice I want you to try out this week. And I want you to take a well-known few verses out of 1 Corinthians chapter 13. You might want to write this down because I know it's not on the screen. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 to 7. I want you to read that passage. It's known as the love passage, right? And so it's read at weddings a lot and so forth. But what I want you to do is I want you to read it a little bit differently this week. And we're going to practice a soul practice called Lectio Divina. That's Latin, fancy Latin word for divine reading, okay? So I want you to experience some divine reading this week with that passage about love. Love is patient, love is kind, so forth, right? But when you read the passage, here's what I want you to do in this process, in this practice. The first thing I want you to do is I want you to read it slowly three times. So usually when we read the Bible, what do? We just read right through like we're reading a novel or reading anything, but Scripture's a little different. So I want you to actually slow it down. And I want you to do it through three times. So I want, this is what I mean. Let me give you a little pacing. Love is patient. Love is kind. See how I'm slowing it down? I want you to slow it down three times. And then I want you to ask yourself the question, what word or phrase draws my attention out of this text? So where do I keep stopping or pausing, or what's being drawn out of the text? So this is the divine reading part of it, is how is God speaking to me through this text? So I want you to do that three times. Then the second thing I want you to do is I want you to then reflect upon that word or phrase. Why do I keep pausing there? Why do I keep having my attention drawn there? Is there something that God may be saying to me specifically through this passage? Again, it's this divine reading. So this is a way for us to meditate on the Scripture, to reflect on the Scripture, to let the Scripture speak to us. And then the third thing has three parts. That's how I snuck in three more points on you. Sorry. So these are the three things I want you to do. So now that you've done the reading, you've done the reflection, I want you just to pray about it. Pray. Talk to God about it. And then just rest. Just be still before God. Just allow yourself to be with that phrase or that word or that prayer. Just be at rest. And then your response. The last thing to do is to respond to it and ask the question, what am I being called to do as a result of this? Is it I need to experience more of God's love? Do I need to see God's love for me this way more? Or is there some way that I need to better love someone else? So I want you to wrestle with that text. And two things I'm hoping are going to happen out of that. One, you're going to experience God's love for you. In fact, you can do that. In every place it says love, just put the word God. God is patient. God is kind. God is not envious. And if you want more about that, I wrote about it in my Pastor's Ponderings this week. If you get that, I go into more detail on that. If you really want all the details on it, go to the book Good and Beautiful God, the chapter, and they give a section in there about Lectio Divina, and you can read that. That goes into great detail about that. But I gave you the cliff notes this morning, all right? So let's pray. God, we come to you this morning thanking you that you love us unconditionally. Your love never gives up on us. No matter whether we've been faithful, unfaithful, you continue to love us. It's not that you want us to remain unfaithful. It's not that you want us to remain in sin and brokenness and sin sickness, but that you want to heal it, that you want to redeem us, that you want to restore us and restore our souls to health. Because Jesus, you are the great physician for the soul. You're our soul collagist. And so, God, we invite you into our lives. We invite your Spirit to heal our souls. And we also pray, God, that you would teach us what it means to love others, to be merciful instead of just sacrificial. Even though we know it, sometimes love is very sacrificial. And sometimes the most loving thing we can do for someone else is to make that sacrifice. And so, Lord, we pray that you would help us know your love better and how much you love us and want to be in our lives. And also, help us to love others. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.